Welcome to Information Service Engineering. This is lecture number 5, Natural Language Processing, Part 4. In this little extra of the current chapter on language models and engrams, we will show you how you can evaluate one of these statistical language models. Okay, so how do we do that? How do we know whether one language model is better than another? In general, you have two different ways to evaluate these models. One way is the so-called intrinsic evaluation. What is that? Intrinsic evaluation captures how well your model captures what it is supposed to capture, which means how well it approximates exactly these kind of probabilities. The extrinsic evaluation is focused on a specific task that you have in mind. So the extrinsic evaluation captures how useful the model is for a particular task. In both cases, you require an evaluation metric that allows us to measure and to compare the performance of these different models. So, let's start with the first one. So, we want to measure how similar the predictions of a model are to real text. How I do this usually, I divide my corpus that I use to develop the language model into two parts. I have a training set, which I consider this is the seen part, and I have a test set, which I consider as the unseen part. Now what I do is I build a language model from the training set. I compute my word frequencies and what I have to do there to come up then in the end with the probabilities. Now for the intrinsic evaluation, I simply estimate the probability of the test set, which means I calculate the so-called average branching factor of the test set. So this is the metric we are going to use for intrinsic evaluation of language models, the average branching factor. How well can we predict the next word in a sequence is in general our question. So I want to show you now how the average branching factor works. So the question of my language model here is, for example, if I say I always order pizza with cheese and, yeah, the language model now should say me what exactly is the next word. Or the winner of the 2018 UEFA Europe League final was which club? I depend on the language model. I saw a, of course, this is much more difficult than the other things. The point is, so for the first one, for example, so on my pizza is cheese and there can be mushrooms, there can be pepperoni, there can be salami. You see the probabilities there. So it's rather likely that one of the typical, I quoted there, pizza ingredients might be there. So the likelihood that strawberries might occur on your pizza, it's rather unlikely. Or the likelihood that after the word and, again the word and follows, it's even more improbable. So therefore, a better language model is one that assigns a higher probability to the word that actually occurs. That should be clear. So this is the problem that is solved here. Again, let's look then at the branching factor. The branching factor of a language is the number of possible next words that can follow any word. And a good language model should try to be able to minimize exactly this number, which means it should give a higher probability to the words that really occur in real texts. And then the average branching factor, this is referred to as perplexity. And this is the most common evaluation metric for engram language models. So the perplexity is a measurement of how well a probability model predicts a sample. So how is it computed? Also quite simple. So the perplexity is a test set, the perplexity of a test set according to a language model is the geometric mean of the inverse test set probability computed by the model. So what's that? We take the test set probability, so the probability of the test set sequence consisting of n words. So we already know how to do that. And what we have to do there is we have to take the geometric mean of the inverse test set probability, which means we have to choose here the nth root of the inverse of the test set probability. This is the geometric mean of the inverse test set probability. And we know already how to do that. So the probability of the sequence here, we simply then fill in according to base and chain rule how we are going to compute that. And then, of course, we can directly compute the perplexity. Considering large text corpora and thereby the low frequencies of the occurrence of n-grams in there, you will see that exactly then trying to compute the perplexity often is limited by the capabilities of your computer, because these numbers become too low and you will get an underflow or something like that. And therefore, what you are going to do then, so since these probabilities are very small, you're going to use logarithms, which means you are using the logarithm of the probability, and in the end you are again then using the exponent of exactly this logarithm to come up with the same number. So this is a simple mathematical transformation, simply for the convenience that we are in the end able to compute really with this small kind of values that we are going to see here when we are trying to come up exactly then with the number of the average branching factor. If I try to compute that, so for a small example, I take the corpus of the Wall Street Journal. These are 19,000 or almost 20,000 words in the vocabulary. The training set is rather large, 38 million words, and I have a test set of 1.5 million words. So you see there, if I want to compute the entire sequence of the text set, so I have lots of multiplications of values that are smaller than zero, and therefore exactly it pays off to calculate the stuff then here via the logarithm, as we have seen. If I now take a language model, for example, only based on unigrams, you see that the perplexity is rather high, 962. So it leaves you then lots of choices. The bigram count is already smaller. So looking at the corpus and the language model we have created from the training set, it only gives us 170 choices here, if I'm using bigrams. If I'm using trigrams, it's even smaller, then only 109. And you will see the higher the number n is that you are going to use, then in the end also the lower the complexity is and the more sophisticated the language model will be. But this is only intrinsic evaluation. So in general, it gives you a value how well, you know, in the end, the test set or parts of your corpus will be approximated by exactly the statistics of the stuff that is also in your corpus. Let's look at a task-based evaluation, extrinsic evaluation, for example. So here, we are going another way. So generally, the perplexity only tells us which language model assigns a higher probability to unseen text, but this doesn't necessarily tell us which of these models actually works better for a specific task that we now have in mind. So we do task-based evaluation, which means we are train a specific model A, plug it into your system for performing a specific task T. Then we evaluate the performance of system A on task T. Then we take the next model, so we train model B, we plug it in and evaluate system B on task T. And we compare now the scores that system A achieved for task T and that system B achieved for task T. And then we can say which one is better. So that would be a task-based evaluation. Now, one way to measure task-based evaluation, so extrinsic evaluation, is based on word error rate. What's the word error rate? Originally, this measurement has been developed for speech recognition, and it tries to find out how much the predicted sequence of words differs from the actual sequence of words in a reference transcript. So you simply ask yourself and put together the number of insertions, deletions, and substitutions which were necessary, you know, to create from the original transcript the predicted transcript. And then you divide this by the number of words in the reference transcript. This is similar to the Levenstein distance. So this is a string similarity measure that you might have already heard of. Following example, so let's say we have the reference transcript, the ground truth, where no man has gone before. And our prediction would be where no man stands alone. So now what I have to do is, how many substitutions do I have to make? So at least two, as you see here, stands alone has to be transferred to has gone. And then I have to do a deletion. So before then is gone. So this is one deletion. I have overall three operations, and my reference transcript contains of six words. So three divided by six gives us a word error rate of 50%. And you see how well your model performs then in a task-based evaluation. Of course, then you have to compare it to another model and then to see what's the word error rate for the other model. So this was it with corpus linguistics and of course how to use statistical language models and n-grams. And of course now in the last section of the lecture you also learned how to evaluate your language models. We will continue with one of the last chapters in natural language processing, which is then another technique. This is part of speech tagging. So in the next section of the lecture, we will find out how we can determine the type of a word and also the sequence of types in a word, which is part of speech tagging.